Hello, and welcome back to Old Kenny's Photography Channel. You know, some of you may be keeping up with me with the 9 years in China channel, but I try to give you some pretty cool information about photography here on this channel. And today, I thought we'd talk about shooting lily pads and lotus flowers, the most beautiful things in the world sometimes. And a lot of people have a lot of problems photographing these. Let me get my mood music going here. When I was in China, my last city, I was there for 3 years in Zhejiang, Jiangsu province. And this was part of the Yangtze River system. So we had lakes and parks and lots of water. And you could walk right up on the flowers and all that kind of stuff. And one of the neat things about summertime, you know, as a photographer is, you know, you got this mid-June, July, and August, the lotuses are going crazy. And it's so much fun to get out and photograph these. Now, I know in America, you know, if you get, like in Arkansas, if you're out walking around trying to photograph lily pads and lotuses, you got to watch out for alligators and snakes and things like that. But in China, there's no worries about this. But I want to share with you lots of photos today and talk about my thought, what I use, the equipment I use to get these pictures, because you'll see some pretty pristine pictures, and you can get it, and you don't have to have a lot of money, you don't have to have a lot of money tied up in your big powerful lenses or anything like that. But to me, there's just something special about shooting the lotus flower and the accompanying, you know, lily pads. First thing first, though, let's kind of go into the thought of this. You got to go to prime specimens. Prime specimen, prime photo. So you got to go to where they're at. And you may have to drive a little ways. You may have to get in a boat. And where you go one day, and there's only a few flowers, in 2 weeks or maybe many. So just like anything else, if you're a landscape photographer, you know, you got to go and go and go and go and go and get the shots. That's no different when you're shooting these lotus flowers and things. Persistence. You got to be willing to go out and get the shot. You hear me talk about getting the shot all the time, but it's true. So you got to find a prime specimen. And as many of them as you can, but it's more than just the specimen. You got to have a setting. If you look at the shots that I'm going to show you here in a little bit, that flower is setting in the midst of lily pads. There's something about it that tells a story. So just a pretty girl is okay. But a pretty girl with the right surrounding, the right background, all of a sudden you can develop something special. It's no different. Anything you shoot, it all works out this way. So you got to look for the specimen. You got to look for the setting. You need good light, but not sunlight. You know, a good hazy day, which might be bad for a landscape, that diffused light may be awesome for shooting models or flowers. Remember, a diffused light lets the colors pop. Direct sunlight creates shadow, and the colors do not pop. The green is not as green. The red is not as red. But you get a little bit of diffused light, some of this golden hour light, or diffused light, and then you got a chance to get something special. And also, when you find those flowers, you got to look at them really careful. You know, you don't pick the ones, no matter what it looks like, don't pick the ones that's got all the little black bugs on it. You can't do it. Standalone dragonfly, standalone toad frog, you know, Bees can be really cool in those shots. But don't shoot the little black bugs. It's ugly. And those little and bugs are so attracted to those flowers. So understand, again, you got to keep on keep on until you find the specimens that you want. Now, for me, the shots that you're going to see in this video, here in just a minute, you're going to see some. And at the end, after we wrap up, you're going to see some more. The one thing I use, a Nikon D5600, the little mid-level, I don't know if you can see that or not, but it's the mid-level, it's the 5600. It has the big touch screen, which is really good for chimping. You know, you can spread everything apart, and you can look at your shot really good as you take it, look at your histogram, you know, and things like that. And yes, on the histogram, I almost always shoot slightly underexposed. To me, it's easier to edit whatever I need to do to the final photo. It's easier to do if I'm not blowing out my highlights, you know. So, and I'm using 300 millimeter lenses. This one here is the AFS 70-300, which is one of my favorite lenses. Nikon quit making it because they want to make those cheaper AFP lenses. But this is technically a full frame lens. It's a 67 millimeter filter size. Really, really good glass. It's got the ED glass. Vibration reduction. It's a fast autofocus. This actually is a good lens for action and things. As long as you're not in low light, this lens will get down on it. It's good for wildlife. The other lens I use is a DX lens, and it's the 55-300, which covers a lot of focal range. And this is these lenses are sharp, really good resolution. Makes high quality pictures, guys. You know, got 24 megapixel camera, good lenses, good glass. The only drawback, if there's a drawback to this lens, it's just that it's slow to autofocus. So it's not my favorite wildlife or action lens, but the picture quality is outstanding. So that's what we're going for. On these photos that you're going to see, we're going for really good picture quality. And I do use this for some wildlife. Just hard chasing down little birds, you know, and getting a fast focus. But 300 millimeter lenses let you get the reach you need. A 7200 is pretty good too, depending on how close you can get to the flowers. Because sometimes they're right on top of you, and you can get these really cool close-ups and highly detailed lotus pads. And sometimes you got to get a little reach. It all just depends on where you're at. But let's take a look here at some pictures, and we'll come back and we'll wrap up. I'll tell you a little bit more about how I shoot the photos. But for usually, I'm walking around out here. I got my 300 millimeter lens. I'm on f/8, f/10, shutter speed about 1/160th of a second. Of course, auto ISO 100. So those are the basic things there. But when we come back, we'll talk about it a little bit more. Okay? So we'll see you in just a minute. Okay, we got to see a few photos. Hope you enjoyed them. I love taking those photos of these guys. I've spent so many hours in the field trying to perfect how I shoot those lotus flowers and those lily pads. And as you saw, the lily pad helps make that photo. It's the relationship between that flower and that lily pad that really makes everything pristine. Just a standalone flower or standalone lily pad can be okay, but it's what you do with that photo, it's that relationship. You know, we're looking at nature here and we're trying to make the most of it. Now, a lot of people look at my photos, look at these photos and think, oh man, he is a Photoshop genius. He is a world-class editor. Nothing can be farther from the truth, I assure you. I do not enjoy editing at all, not really, but it's a necessary evil. The biggest plus is I try to get the best shot I can in camera. And so it gives me less time I have to do any kind of editing. And I'll be honest with you, these photos that you see here are not edited very much at all. The prime specimen, the good colors, are what brings out the photo. Now, I do like to see some light coming through the lily pad, so the veining of the lily pad looks really, really good. I want the best colors. I want that combination of violet or white and violet in the lotus flower. I want to see some contrast. And one thing I will do when I edit, of course, I make sure everything's straight and all that. And I don't like to have the flower in the center. I almost never have the flower in the center. That's a tourist photo. I try to bring my flower to some kind of a corner, you know, up, down, whatever looks best. If I gotta crop something, I'm gonna crop it to where we get to see lots of detail. We get to see all that flower, but it's not gonna be in the center. I'll do that. But I usually, when I point at that flower, I'm at the composition I want anyhow. I don't like going back and cropping too much. I like my pictures to be as big as they can. So if they do want to be printed later, no problem. And most all my photos with my DX cameras, my Fine Art America prints, go up to like about 40 by 26.5. So that's a gigantic print, living room photo size. So don't worry about that. If you're shooting, and you can still do a little cropping and still get that same size photo. But anyhow, back to the lily pad. Sometimes when I'm editing, if I don't think I see enough detail, I'll take I use iPicky. They have what they call local contrast, local contrast. And I'll play with the contrast just a little bit and see if I can pull those veins out a little more clear. And sometimes, if there's a little bit of sunlight, you know, and the photo looks a little flat, I'll go into vibrance. And I got this rule about vibrance, though. I don't want to use any more than 20%. So I'll get my little slide and I'll go up until I've got about, you know, 15 to 20% vibrance. And usually that makes the color go and pop a little bit more. And I do this with people, too. When I shoot people, every once in a while, you know, your photo might look a little flat for some reason or another. And just a little bitty bit of vibrance can really make the skin pop and still look natural. That's the whole idea. We're shooting nature, we're shooting, you know, whatever we're shooting, we want it to look natural, we want it to look believable. I hate to see things that are over-edited. It looks so horrible, and people do it all the time. Don't do that. Make it look great, but natural. So anyhow, when it comes to editing, I try not to edit very much at all. I want the best shot I can in camera. Then we'll go through, and if we got to sharpen up something or whatever, we just do that. But everything pretty much stays exactly like you saw it in the field. So what you need to do, you need to start locating where these flowers grow. You know, and depending on where you're at, you may have to drive a few miles. And you may have to drive a few miles every week until you get some prime photos. And it's out there to get. And when you get out there on one of those days where everything's prime and you can get up close and get nice shots, you can back off and get some group shots of those things, you can really, really, really create some art. Because they're those flowers and prime specimens, you know, those are like thoroughbred horses. You know, don't take pictures of little Shetland ponies pulling a wagon. Take a picture of a thoroughbred horse. You know, take a picture of an Arabian. You know, so that's what you, the mentality you got to have when you go out there. So anyhow, we're going to show some more photos, and we're wrapping in, we'll be all wrapped up. But I hope you enjoy what you've seen today. My equipment is not, I don't do anything elaborate. I got a, you know, what is it, a $900 camera and really good glass. You know, it, the 70 to 300 here, is, this was a full frame, about $500 glass. The 55 to 300 is under $400. And they really good stuff, really good stuff. And you don't need any more. Just pop some of that in your bag, get your little puffer and something to wipe your lens down or whatever and get out there. But anyhow, hope you have a good day. I hope you enjoy this video. I enjoy talking about one of my favorite things to photograph. And I know if you do it right, you'll enjoy it too. So anyhow, have a great day, and we'll see you later. And look for some more pictures here in just a minute. All right? So bye-bye.